Good morning, church. The call to worship. The Lord is coming soon. Make ready your hearts to receive him.
Many are not sure what to do. How can we be ready? May the Lord direct us.
The Lord is bringing peace to you. The Lord has come to seek and save the lost. Praise be to God who saves us from our sins. Amen. Amen. And as we continue our worship, I know that the Lord has been moving, have been speaking, have been, you know, everything does have been just have been coordinating as we go into just another session of praise and worship. I just showed Johnny a song, the last song that Rev started, If You Know the Lord Is Keeping You. That was one of the songs that I had on my list this morning. But we're not going to start with that chorus this morning. We're going to start with, you know, when we used to go back in those days when we go to our, because this is evangelism service this morning. This is our evangelism service. And I just want to sing some chorus that we used to sing back in those days when we go to the crusades and evangelistic service. Songs like Something Down Inside of Me. Do we all remember those chorus?
Yes.
Something down inside of me, telling me to go on. Something down inside of me, telling me to go on. Oh, something down inside of me, telling me to go on. Go on, go on, go on. Let's sing it one more time. Oh,
something down inside of me, telling me to go on.
Oh,
something down inside of me, telling me to go on.
Let me hear the hands clapping this morning.
Something down inside of me, telling me to go on.
Go on,
go on, go on, go on.
It's the Holy Ghost inside of me.
Oh, the Holy Ghost down inside of me, telling me to go on. Oh, the Holy Ghost down inside of me, telling me to go on. The Holy Ghost down inside of me, telling me to go on.
Go on, go on, go on. If you know the Lord is keeping you,
if you know the Lord is keeping you, what you gonna worry about? If you know the Lord is keeping you, why don't you sing and shout?
Oh, glory, hallelujah,
praise his name. Every day is just the same. If you know the Lord is keeping you, what you gonna worry about?
One more time.
About?
If you know, oh,
if you know the Lord is keeping you, what you gonna worry about? If you know the Lord is keeping you, then why don't you sing and shout?
Oh, glory, oh,
glory, hallelujah, praise his name. Every day is just the same. If you know the Lord is keeping you, what you gonna worry
about? What a mighty
about?
God we serve! What a mighty God we serve! Do you remember those chorus? Oh, what a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God, oh,
angels bow before him.
Heaven and earth adore him.
Oh, what a mighty God we serve.
Do we serve a mighty God this morning? What a mighty God. Oh, what a
mighty God we serve.
What a mighty God.
What a mighty God.
What a mighty God, yes.
Angels go before him.
Oh, heaven and earth adore him.
What a mighty God.
Oh, Daniel, God,
surely will deliver. Daniel, God, surely will deliver. If you only
look to him
by faith, Daniel, God, surely will deliver.
Daniel, God, oh,
Daniel, God, surely will deliver. Daniel, God, surely will deliver. If you only
look
to him by faith, Daniel, God, surely will deliver.
If you only
look to him by faith, Daniel, God, surely will deliver.
One more time.
If you only look to him by faith, Daniel, God, surely will deliver.
Let's lift our hands and worship the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Daniel, God, surely will deliver. As we continue to worship God, we want to sing some more of these choruses. Amen.
I've been fighting a war to come along, having a glorious time. Nobody knows. We're going to the city where moonlight never shines. We may not know.
Service this morning
in the blood,
in the blood,
the Lamb, are your garments spotless, are they white and so are you one in the blood of the Lamb.
Let's lift our hands and worship the Lord this morning. Thank you, Jesus. As we prepare our hearts, you may be seated. As we prepare our hearts for prayer, we're going to sing song Hallelujah, the Agnus Dei, Hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. As we look to the Lord this morning, so we sing prayerfully.
Lamb that was slain. We say, gracious God, you are worthy. Worthy of our praise. Worthy of all worship. Worthy of adoration. And so, God, we come before you this morning. We just want to exalt your holy and matchless name. We surrender all ourselves at the altar. We say, God, take control, because you are God. We say, God, we are not worthy, but thou art worthy. We say, God, we are not strong, but you are strong. We say, God, we are poor, but you are rich. God, we thank you this morning for life. We thank you for strength. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to come into your house and just to worship you. Even as we are here this morning, God, and we worship you in spirit and in truth, we dare not fail to recognize the shortcomings in ourselves. Lord, there are things that we have done that we know so well that they were against your rules and regulations, yet still we still went ahead and did them. Also, God, there are things that we did that we know not that they were wrong, that were against your regulations. We fail to do the things, God, which you asked us to do, and the things that you say we should stay far apart from. Those are the things that we cling to, Lord God. And so we, your people this morning, we ask you that you will forgive our sins, even as you forgive our sins, O Lord. We ask you that you will make us whole. Let this morning's worship be sweet, and that you will be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. People of God, the scripture reminds us that whosoever the Son sets free is truly free indeed. As you believe in your heart, express with your mouth through the service, through singing and thanksgiving, that the Lord has truly set you free. Amen.
At this time, we'll have the lighting of the Advent candle, hope.
Today marks the beginning of Advent in the church calendar. So really today is the start of the new year, the Christian year. And so happy new Christian year to you all. In Advent there are four Sundays before Christmas. And each Sunday has a particular theme or motive. Today's theme is hope, and there's joy, peace, love, and then there's Christmas Day, the white candle represents Christ. So we're going to sing the hymn listed there. The first one. First verse, the candle of hope we light in this hour proclaims that the Lord is coming in power. We wait for a future now hidden from view, where Christ in his glory will make all things new. I need a volunteer, a child big enough who's allowed to handle matches to come and help me light the candle. Okay, come on down. Let's sing the candle of hope. The tune is O Worship the King. Da 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 da. Says amidst all the darkness around us, whether the pandemic or the loss or death of a loved one, the hurt or the pain, difficulty of a lost job, in the midst of all that, we proclaim that Christ has come into the world and he will make all things new, that Christ has come and will come again. We proclaim that, as John says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never overpower it. So let's sing again. The candle of hope we light in this hour. God will make all things new one day. In that spirit then, I want to welcome everyone here on behalf of the leadership of the church. I want to welcome you most warmly to this house of worship on this day of worship. We are so very glad you are here and you're able to join us in this time of worship and praise and celebration. So welcome, welcome everyone. We want in the sanctuary, we want to welcome all those who are joining us online, whether you are on our website at ridgemountunited.org, whether you're watching us on YouTube, youtube.com/ridgemountunited, or facebook.com/ridgemountunited. You can find us on any of those places. And if you're watching and joining in the worship this morning, we welcome you most warmly. And we are glad you are able to join us in worship wherever you are. Those of us here gathered in the sanctuary, we are very happy to have you as we worship the Lord together in the beauty of holiness. I want to extend a special welcome to a few persons. We have the family of our sister Lucinda Powell. If you're here for that, Sister Powell, just raise your hand. All right, so welcome, welcome, glad to have you. We have the family of our brother Francis, who we laid to rest on Friday, and we're happy to have two of his relatives here this morning. Welcome, glad to have you as well. Anybody here, apart from those already mentioned, anybody here for the first time? Anybody here for the first in a long time? Welcome. All right, so welcome everybody. Just turn to somebody next to you, let them know you're happy to see them. Glad that they're beside you. I want to remind us of the COVID protocols to make sure that in the congregation that you are masked, right? You're wearing a face covering. that if you're not sitting beside somebody who lives in your house, you are not supposed to be more than 6 feet beside them, right? So bear that in mind as well. And we ask that you make sure that you are, you did sanitize and you did check your temperature before you came in. Also want to remind you that when you go out, if you have to go out, please make sure to observe the physical distancing requirements when you go out in the public if you must, and only go out if you must. School might not be keeping in the classroom, but COVID is everywhere. So please make sure to abide by those regulations. I just share with you a few more bits of news. You will notice we have two lecterns for the scripture readers. When you come, one, please use that one. Birthday. If you're here and you hear your name, just be standing and we will acknowledge you. If you have a birthday this week and your name has not been called, you may also stand as well. On the 29th, Stacey and Carpenter Brown and Reginald Griffiths. On the 30th, Everett Davis, Joyce Powell, Cecil Williams, and Deanna Woodstock. And that completes November. In December, on the 1st, Shauna K. Gilpin and Carolyn Michelle Clark, Donovan Reed, and Turhan Sinclair. On the 2nd of December, Alonzo Francis and Sheldon McLaughlin and Courtney James. And on the 3rd of December, Jermaine Webley. None of those persons here. Anybody in the congregation celebrating a birthday this week? Okay. Wedding anniversaries this week on December 1, Alfred and Faye Christian. Merrick and Joan Russell, Donald and Beverly Myrie. And just want to let you know last week that the Douglases celebrated their anniversary, and it was their 59th. Renford and Mary Douglas celebrated 59 years. Right? Anybody in the congregation celebrating a wedding anniversary? Anybody get a job promotion? Anybody? Any milestone, any achievements? All right, no? All right, so we wish our birthday celebrants well and our anniversary couples. We wish them God's richest blessing and strength as they go on. Ask you to remember our sick and shut-in sisters and brothers. Please keep them in your prayers. Give them a call if you're able to. We're not encouraging in-person visits, but if you can, please give them a call and let them know we have not forgotten them. As well as those who have lost loved ones. You'll see on the bulletin, our sister Marie, who is here, we continue to pray for her. Family of our sister Lucilla Powell, and we'll celebrate and remember her in a little while in the service. Our sister Cherry Bennett, who is watching us online, death of her nephew. Sister Marcia Fisher on the passing of her father. Sister Joan Williams on the passing of her nephew. Not on the bulletin, our sister Jackie Thompson, on the death of her father. Our brother Philip Perkins on the death of his brother. We want to remember these persons and lift them up before God. So we ask you, when you go to prayer, please mention their names before the Lord. All right, we'll have our pastoral prayer in a little while. Other items of news, please remember our times of prayer on a Sunday morning before the 9 o'clock service, 8:15 in the grief recovery room. If you come, the room will be open and you just want to go in and pray, that is fine as well. We have two services here on a Sunday morning at 7 and 9, and you're invited to either one of them. Last night we had our once a month praise casual contemporary worship service, and if you were not able to be here, you can watch it. It's on our Facebook page and on our YouTube channel as well. Um, So remember those times of prayer on a Sunday morning, on a Wednesday morning at 6, right here in the sanctuary. And the United Church invites us to pray every Wednesday at 12, between 12 and 1, wherever you are, to pray particularly about the COVID situation. I want to thank you for your continued support of the work of the church and your giving, and I encourage you to continue to give, and if you can, give online, and we appreciate that, and we thank you. Those of you who can't, don't have access to online facilities, can bring it to the office here, or you can bring it to church on a Sunday. All right, so we ask you to continue to support the work of the church. Some upcoming events that are important for us as a church family. On the second Sunday in December, immediately following the 9 a.m. worship, will be our congregational meeting, where we will present the plans and budget for 2021. We ask you to prepare for that. We'll keep the service tight. That will allow you to worship freely, but also be able to stay for the congregational meeting. In the afternoon will be our hybrid symphony in sanctuary and online. Symphony number 42, 41, I think it is. So please mark those two dates, second Sunday in December. On the third Sunday, the 20th of December, is our pledging Sunday. We ask you to come prepared to indicate the areas in the life of the church that you are willing to serve and how you intend to support the work of the church for 2021. So please mark those two important dates in December, the second and third Sunday, two very important Sundays. We ask you to make a special effort to be here and to share in those activities and events. All right, so those are the things to remind you of. Our Bible study is on this Wednesday, 5:30, on Zoom. If you want the link, just call the office and we will send it to you via email or on WhatsApp. All right, so please bear those things in mind, as well as this last one. Our Daily Bread devotionals for 2021 are available as of next week. They are $350 each. You can either get it here at church on Sunday, or you can come and buy at the office in the week. So please make a note of those, and may God bless you all as we worship together. Let us unite our hearts in prayer this time. Loving Lord, we thank you for moments of celebration, laughter, and joy. So, Lord, we thank you for those who will celebrate a birthday this week. Thank you for life, the life you have given unto them. We ask your blessing upon them, even as we bless the day they were born. Lord, we think of those who are marking another year of togetherness. We ask you to keep them close and bind them together with your love. Lord, we think of those who are sick, and we ask for your special healing touch upon their lives. And those who grieve, may your spirit comfort them. So, Lord, we present the needs of our congregation, those who have lost jobs, those who are looking for places to live, those, Lord God, who are hurting in one way or another. We just ask your blessing upon them, and we pray, mighty God, that they will experience your healing power and your healing presence in their lives. Bless them now, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. Just before we have this morning's offering, I'm sure Stanford would want me to say thanks to you all for your tremendous support to the harvest last weekend. And despite the COVID, it was a good harvest. We had a good time on Saturday and a good time in worship on Sunday. And if you were not able to bring your harvest offering before, we are still open to receiving it. All right. This morning's offering, there are baskets here. The procedure is, I'm going to invite ushers to just come, one on either side to direct you. Bench by bench, each bench comes up, keep moving forward and go back to your seats. No turning back. Just drop it in the baskets there. Those on this side, this basket. Those on this side, this basket. You come down the center aisle, keep going forward and return to your seats. And you try to maintain the 6 feet distance. Ushers, please come and direct. Musicians, please lead us.
sacrifice is a thanksgiving, and we offer unto you the sacrifice. We bring a sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring a sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving, and we offer up to you the sacrifices of praise. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, and we offer unto you the sacrifices of thanksgiving, and we offer unto you the sacrifices of
strength. And Lord, as we give you back a portion of what we have earned, Father, we ask, Lord, that you'll bless it. And Lord, may you help us that we may use it wisely for the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we continue our morning's worship, I'll ask Rev to come at this time.
Sisters and brothers, as you are aware, because of the COVID protocols, funeral services are not permitted at this time. But we feel that we'd want to provide an opportunity to show support and solidarity with members of our community who have lost loved ones. And so, as we have tried to do in the past, we set aside a time in our morning worship to remember those who have passed. And I've had multiple opportunities to do that because quite a few of our members have died. This morning, we want to remember and celebrate the life of our sister, Lucilda Powell, known to most of us as Lucille Powell, but her birth name is actually Lucilda Powell. Members of her family are here with us this morning, and we want to provide this opportunity to let them know that we are with you. Normally, you'd have a funeral service and the church would be full of people, you know, remembering her and all of that. We can't do that, but we want to set aside this brief moment to remember her life and to celebrate the gift that she was to us here at Ridgemount and to her family. From the Ridgemount side, in the time I've been here, when I came here, Sister Paul was already shut in and unable to come out to church. But we were happy that we had the opportunity to visit her on a regular basis, a fairly regular basis, along with members of the visiting team, particularly Sister Monica Spencer and Sister Norma Smith, who were her regular visitors. The story is told of her long connection to this church, walking many miles from, let's call it the south, to church here. Her active involvement in the Women's Fellowship and her generous support to the work of the church. The Women's Fellowship was perhaps the area she was most involved in when she was able. And so we want to acknowledge that and to affirm that she is a part of us, that she made her contribution while she was here, that she gave of herself and her resources in the service of Christ. My visits with her were always joyful because she would always have stories to tell, told with great, very pleasant demeanor, always a smile. The smile would shine through as she spoke. And so we give God thanks for her, and we look forward to the day when we will see her again, when we'll join with the angels and all the saints who have gone before us in proclaiming the goodness of God. We're going to stand and sing Face to Face with Christ My Savior. Then I'm going to invite, I think there are two tributes from the family members.
To face with Christ my Savior, face to face, what will it be? When the rapture I behold in Jesus Christ who died for me, face to face with Christ. Far beyond the starry sky, face to face in all His glory, I shall see Him by and by. Only faintly now I see Him with the darkened veil. But a blessed day is coming when His glory shall be seen. Face to face to behold Him far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all His glory, I shall see Him by and by. What rejoicing in His presence, when all banish grief and pain, when the crooked way is straightened, and the dark things shall be plain. Face to face I shall behold Him far beyond the starry sky. with glory. I shall see him by and by. Face to face, oh blissful moment. Face to face to see and know. Face to face with my Redeemer, Jesus Christ, who loved me so. Face to face I shall behold.
You went in there, the person is doing the tributes to come at this time.
Simpson, granddaughter of Miss Powell. And I am reading this tribute on behalf of her daughter, Leone Bramwell, who is in the United States and is unavoidably absent. And it reads, "You were a precious gift from God. So much beauty, grace, love, and patience you possessed. You touched my heart in so many ways. Your strength and smile, even on the dark days, made me realize I had an angel beside me. Your selfless acts of kindness, your sincere advice, your love for family, what a loving being you were. My mom would sit down and listen to anything that people were saying. She had time for anyone and everyone. Her spontaneous laughter would keep you going. I thank God every day for what mom taught me through the years. She was a spiritual and godly mother. This tribute to my late mother can't even express the smallest love and gratitude I have for her. Mom taught me to love God. She taught me endurance. Through her example, we learned to push on even when things seem impossible. Mother's devotion to God and love for her family was absolute. My mother never usually complained about anything. From this experience, we learned a valuable lesson. There is always a reward for those who endure hardships and obey God. 2 Timothy 2, verse 3. She taught us to always focus on God's grace and not the sacrifice. She would always say, it's not as bad as it looks. Mom always taught me about faithfulness. Over the years, I have tried to emulate her best way I could. If you start anything, always make sure to complete it. She also emphasized on the importance of giving your word. She used to pray a lot. My mother also taught me to take care of others and the difference between right and wrong. She taught me to make the right decisions and reminded me about God's kindness and love for me and everyone. I know life is better where you are now, my beautiful angel. I miss you more than you know. Goodbye, Mom, until we meet again to part no more." This ends this tribute from daughter of Miss Powell, Leone Bramwell.
We're trying to get a picture up so you can, those of you who may not have known her. You'll be able to see what she looks like.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Yannick Levy, granddaughter to Priscilla Powell. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh. is a clear reminder of the season of life. I would have spent my childhood, adolescence, and early adult years with Grandma. She was a kind, loving, caring, humble, jovial, yet stern person. Oh, how could I forget? She had a smile that lights up your day. She made every effort to meet all the needs of her grandchildren, especially my brother, Damian Thompson, and myself. They considered us to be the favorite. She instilled important values such as patience, respect, integrity, and dedication, which today I make every effort to be guided by. One of my fondest memories was a time when a neighbor stormed up to Grandma's house, accusing her that her dogs had scattered the garbage at her gate. The lady was quite irate and loud. As she expressed her displeasure with what she believed that the dog had done, Grandma allowed the lady to speak and with a gentle smile responded to her saying, "I don't own a dog." Grandma was a firm disciplinarian who will not fear giving you a bathtub or shower beating with her infamous belt from Miss Matar, her previous employer, who she spoke greatly about. Her unforgettable kindness was exhibited in many ways, but I can remember a time after washing my newborn's clothes, she was outside hanging out the clothes at age 88 years old. She would have words of advice concerning choosing a partner. It was no detailed lecture, but a few words. Clothes are medicine, meaning don't be fooled by the appearance or dressed by a male because it might be a wolf in sheep clothing. Today, I'm guided by this and countless examples given by Grandma. Though I would have gone on my own 4 years now, I would make several trips to West Road day and night, and even making sleepovers by her home. What can I say? Grandma, loving, unique, charitable, industrious, dedicated, admirable, and a virtuous woman. Grandma, thank you for being the person you were. You will always be in our hearts. Thank you.
Amen. Face to face shall I behold him, far beyond the starry sky.
Face to face in all its glory.
Prayer this time. We want to lift up the family before God. As you heard, long life, life well lived, a life of impact and influence, an exemplary life. May her soul rest in peace and may light perpetual shine upon her. Lord, we ask for your strength for them and your blessing upon them. May the memories of Sister Powell continue to reverberate in their lives. May the joy brought by her, Lord God, cause a smile to come on their faces. And may they know, Lord God, that she is at peace, resting in your presence. So, Lord, we pray for comfort and strength and guidance and courage for the days ahead. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Rev. As we listen and respond to God's word this morning, the praise team will do the song Gracefully Broken. My Faith Walk, we'll ask Kirk to come. But before the praise team, I just want to share with the church that when we're planning for this service, you know, just wanted to tell you how God has been speaking. That we wanted to, what needed somebody to share that testimony. And in that meeting, you know, when we said, okay, we need someone to share their faith, we thought about it. And, you know, after a while, God revealed that, well, he inspired Johnny to, you know, openly said, well, he was thinking about Kirk. And I said to him that it was the same person I was thinking about. And I believe that God wanted Kirk to share his faith this morning. So as we prepare for the faith walk by Kirk, just gonna ask the praise team to do the song, Gracefully Broken.
Hallelujah. Give him a hallelujah this morning, hallelujah. Praise God, hallelujah. Multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, oh,
oh.
I have
in these hands
and multiply, God. All that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Here I am, God.
God, arms wide open.
to Jesus now. I'm holding nothing back.
All to Jesus, yes.
All to Jesus now.
I'm holding nothing.
I'm holding nothing back.
I surrender.
I surrender.
Church. God is good. And all the time. Well, do I should have given away half of my story already. But you know, I'm not a man of many words, but I'll try to be as brief as possible as well. Most of you would have been here last year, December, when I took the decision. I got up from my seat down there and I came right up here and I got baptized. It has been a journey, but it didn't start there. I've had some experiences throughout my life, which I mean everybody would have had their experiences. And I have realized that most of those experiences, they happen for a reason. And 6.5 years ago, I lost my mother and a very close friend of mine, pretty much 2 or 3 days apart. And today it has been the worst experience I've ever had in my entire life. And I remember comparing both of them, and I looked at the lives that both of them lived, and I said to myself, but none of this matters. No, because they are gone. So if the life was not what Christ wanted, it would have made no sense, none whatsoever. And when Dwight called me earlier in the week, I hesitated a bit, but I listened. And he said to me that he had me on his mind, and he also said that Johnny had me on his mind as well. And I said, you know what, I can't even tell you no, because it must be for a reason. And I told him I'd get back to him, but of course the real reason was that I wanted to call my wife first, which I did, and then I called back Dwight. I called back Dwight and I said, okay, no problem. And I thought about it all week. I didn't know what to come up here and say to you guys, to be honest. Even driving to church, I was thinking, what am I going to say? And two things came to my mind. One of which, our lives, it's not ours. It doesn't belong to us. It's not our own. And whenever you get that call, you're going to get that call. Whenever you get that call, you need to answer that call. And when you answer the call, you need to act accordingly after you answer that call and you make that decision. When I left here in December, I felt differently. And adding to the experience that I told you that I had, I remember at one time, not ours. And I was a bit disappointed when that probably about 2-3 months passed and it didn't happen. Then, but there was something that I was not comfortable with. And God removed that thing from me that I wasn't comfortable with. And then the situation came back to me. And you know, my wife said to me, Kirk, don't do it. And I said, Shelley, I cannot ask God for something. And he presented it to me in his own time. And then I am going to question it. I said, I cannot question it. There's no way I can question it. And I went ahead and I did it. And
this is a text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the prophets and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This was after King Jehoiachin and the queen mother, the court officer, and the leader of Judah and Jerusalem, the craftsmen and the artisan had gone into exile from Jerusalem. He entrusts the letter to Elisha, son of Shaphan, and Jeremiah, son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent to the king of Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. It says, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carry into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens, eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters into marriage, so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in numbers there, do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I carry you into exile. Pray for it because it for it to prosper, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. This is what the Lord said. When 70 years are complete from Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my gracious presence to bring you back to this place. For I know the plan I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. 14 and last, I will be found by you, declare the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and place where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carry you into exile. Heareth the reading of God's holy word.
A reading from a portion of his scripture according to St. John the Divine. The vine and the branches. Chapter 15, 1 to 12 reads, I am the true vine, and my Father is a gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that doesn't bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit of itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. This is my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My commands is this: love each other as I have loved you. The word of the Lord.
As we prepare for the message this morning by Johnny, we're going to stand and sing, "You Are God Alone." And as we stand, you know, we're just happy this morning that we have a God, we are serving a God this morning who is not created by human hands. Amen. Are we happy for that this morning? We have a God this morning who is not dependent on any mortal man. Are we happy this morning that we are serving a God that is not in need of anything we can give, but by your plan? That's just the way it is. Let's just worship our Lord this morning as we sing, "You Are God Alone."
You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plans. That's just the way it is.
Let's sing it one more time.
God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plans. That's just the way it is.
You are God alone.
You are God alone from before time began. You are on your throne. You are God alone. And right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne. You are God alone.
Unshakable,
unshakable, unstoppable.
Church, give God thanks this morning. Let's pray. Father, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts will be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Morning again, friends. Multimedia, I want to apologize to you from now, because by now I think the church knows I don't talk from a script. I talk from the heart, and I have a few points I want to make. The slides are scattered around. There should be some PowerPoint slides there, so you're going to have to just sort through and follow back on me, because they are not necessarily in order. You know, when I was contemplating what are the things I would share this morning, I'm a morning person, so I got up early, and somebody gave me a mug, a coffee mug. There should be a picture of it up there. And it had Jeremiah 29, verse 11, written on it. "For I know the plans I have for you." Yeah, that is it there. "I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you, give you a future, give you hope, says the Lord." You know, that scripture has been commercialized so much. It's on my coffee mug. I'm sure it's on a plaque, maybe in some of your houses. Yeah, it's on table mats. It's all over the place. And sometimes the context gets lost. Do we realize, as Marceline read this morning, that scripture was part of a letter written by Jeremiah, giving God's word to a people in exile? And that's not a fairy tale nor a parable. The children of Israel were ravaged by the Babylonian Empire, led by King Nebuchadnezzar. I believe it was 500 and something BC, don't quote me on it. But they came in and they ravaged the nation of Israel, and they took away the choice things. They didn't bother with the riffraff. They selected the skilled craftsmen, the carpenters, the stone makers, the king and the queen mother was taken away, the royalty, all the officials, the leadership were packed up and enslaved by the Babylonians, and the nation of Israel was ravaged. This was a letter, the word of the Lord from Jeremiah, and the context of that scripture was delivered to a people in exile. And we think COVID is bad. We not start seeing nothing yet. Think of it. All that you knew, all your plans, your little, you know, "I want to grow up to be the best carpenter." Gone. Gone. Enslaved by a foreign people. And yet, in the context of that, God delivered a message of hope. You know, most of you would know by now that I am, put it this way, I did not appreciate in my earlier days the depth and symbolism of the Christian liturgical calendar. Them things didn't really move me. But as I grow and I'm getting older, I realize the purpose and the symbolism of the candle and all of that. And I was quite surprised that today we lit the candle of hope. And that's the message in Jeremiah 29, that God, in the midst of our calamity, is giving us a strong message of hope. You know, God is not just some supreme vapor floating around the place and orchestrating different things and is unconcerned. He's a very present and real help in time of need. I believe it was earlier this week, my younger daughter asked me, could have been yesterday or day before, Jody, asked me, what, Daddy, what is an atheist? And I said, you know, initially I thought, well, it's somebody who doesn't believe in God. And then I corrected myself. No. An atheist is somebody who believes that God does not exist. It's not that you don't believe in God. An atheist believes God does not exist. That's a dying breed, you know. Because the more and more that we look outside, the heavens declare the glory of the Lord. The firmament shows his handiwork, the psalmist tells us. And I started reading and doing some research. I think I have a few slides on that. Do you know that, you know, in my days of chemistry and physics, there was the smallest unit was the atom. And the atom, all of you, dial back the ears. You had what is in the middle of the atom, the proton, and the neutron in the nucleus, and electrons going around it. That's ancient history now, you know. I read last night or night before of something called the neutrino. The neutrino has no electrical charge, and it has a mass of zero because it can't be measured. The mass is so small. Everybody hold up your thumb. If you are outside and you hold up your thumb to the sun, you will get a stream of neutrinos, 10 billion neutrinos coming through your thumb. 8.5 minutes ago, they were in the heart of the sun. That's not fairy tale, that is fact. Matter of fact, the gentleman Ray Davis that discovered the neutrino, equation of a balance, and they are now realizing there are three types of neutrinos. And the more and more we think we know squat about this universe. We don't begin to understand or fathom the length and the breadth and the depth of who God is. Light travels at something like, I think I have a slide on it, 600 and something million miles per hour. That's the speed of light. And that's how they measure the universe size. The amount of time it takes light to travel in 1 year is called a light year. Scientists right now are kind of estimating that our universe is 93 million light years. Big. Matter of fact, there are some theories, well, not theories, it's proven. The universe actually is expanding and getting bigger. It's moving. And they actually extrapolate back from that to say, guess what? Do you know? Big discovery. The universe started, it wasn't always here. It started from a moment in time. I could have told them that from Genesis. Because when you look on the rate and movement of the stars, you realize it started. That generated the Big Bang Theory. It's not a TV show, by the way. It's actually a scientific theory, the Big Bang Theory, that the universe was created from an event, and it's actually still moving out. I learned about things. You ever heard of dark energy? They are discovering something now. Equations don't balance. At the center of many of the galaxies are what we call black holes, where the gravitational pull is so strong that not even light can come from it. And it just sucks all the gravity, all the light to itself, a black hole. And they're now doing calculations and discovering that there's something called dark energy. Brothers and sisters, people out there, we don't begin to understand and fathom the God we serve. And we think COVID is a challenge. We don't begin to understand. Even when you dial it down and look on a, forget the macro, all right? That just is mind-blowing. The fact that we are part of a galaxy and the galaxies are part of a universe, and the universe, there might be more than one. Let's just even dial it back. Francis Schaeffer in his book, Crazy Love, was giving some facts. This is not in any of the slides. Do you know a caterpillar, something that lived for a few days, has 228 distinct muscles in its head that allows it to move up and down. A caterpillar. Do you know that a spider generates 3 different types of silk and can make up to 60 feet of silk per hour? A spider, something that when we're ready, we use bagon and kill. We don't begin to understand the minute depth and attention and focus that our God is capable of. It's mind-blowing. You know, I didn't invite Kurt to speak because he's an Arsenal fan, or the fact that Rev, who has left, is an Arsenal fan. And you all know by now that I'm a Liverpool man, so I had my best moment of 30 years when Liverpool lifted the title. It's football I'm talking about, for those of you that don't know. Right. But after last year's Premier League, there was a hiatus, and with COVID, can't play no ball, can't watch no ball. And I had a friend who introduced me to Formula One. And I started to watch. Now, Formula One wasn't really floating my boat. 60 odd times, really. But I decided to look, and boy, I was amazed. What Mercedes, McLaren, Honda has done with the car. It is simply amazing. If you sit down and look on Formula One and you begin to realize. And then I look back. Yeah, how many of you remember a Lada?
Yeah.
Now, no offense to our Russian friends. I know it's a progress, but when I look on McLaren and Mercedes and look on Lada, I can appreciate the quality of design, don't it? When you look on nowadays Lexus and you think of the old-time Jalopy, you can appreciate. Well, guys, it's like this. Believing that there is no God is like you take some stones and shake them together and throw them out and you produce a Mercedes Benz. It takes more faith to believe that there is no God than to recognize God's handiwork and craft. If we can look on a car and say, boy, the man them good, may I tell you? If we can look on a car and say that, how can we ignore the universe around us? How can we ignore the fact that God created a caterpillar with 228 distinct muscles in its head? Brethren, God says to us this morning, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and give you future and a hope. That's the message for us this morning. You know, I was reading in a devotional the other day about a story of a man who was driving along somewhere in the U.S. And this was set in about the 30s when the car was just made and was turning the world upside down. Everybody wanted a car. This guy had a car and car broke down on the road. He came out and lifted up. He didn't know where to start. And he was just looking at the engine. Up drove a limousine, black limousine. Pass, stop, reverse. Window came down. And a very well-dressed man, jacket and tie, said, is everything all right? He said, no, I've broken down. Said, don't worry. Pulled over, came out, took off his jacket, took off his tie, rolled up his sleeves, and proceeded in 20 or 30 minutes to diagnose and rectify the problem in the car. The gentleman was amazed. He said, boy, my name is so-and-so. What's your name? Thanks so much. He says, my name is Henry. Henry Ford. He was on his way to a board meeting, and he stopped and saw one of his cars on the side of the road, and he felt personally responsible. He said, the board can wait. This is what pays me. This is what pays the board. And he stopped and helped and diagnosed that person. Brethren, can I tell you, if Henry Ford can do that, how much more God, our maker, our designer, that has put so much craft in a caterpillar, how much more does he care about our plans and our future? This is a moment where we can break, where we can think about our life. God has a plan for us. But you know, brethren and sisters, sadly enough, many of us go through our life without recognizing that purpose and that plan. It's not because God doesn't want the best for us. He has given us the choice of free will. And you know, along the way, he knows we mess up. And to make sure that we can't use our bad decisions, our indiscretions, our wrongs, our sins as a reason for not connecting to him, he came down first Sunday in Advent. We celebrate today the fact that God left his throne and came down to remove sin as a reason why we can't connect to him and gave his very life. That's the God we serve. But sadly enough, he has, not all of us have made that choice. God will never take away our free will, because that's how he made us. If he wanted robots, he would have made us like stones or the trees. He made us unique. Scientists now, I read in Google last night that scientists are now beginning to accept the fact that it could be that there is no life anywhere else in the universe other than Earth, because it's just unique. That's the God of design, of craft. Forget Mercedes. We have an example here that's just mind-blowing. But dial it down to an individual level. That's the God we serve. Kirk came up here and shared his testimony. I can tell you, I'm not here because of neutrinos or Mercedes Benz. I am here because in my walk, in my relationship with God, I reached a stage where I said, God, help me. I want to know you. And I saw God work in my life in a way that is just inexplicable. That's why I'm here. That's why Kirk made the decision he made. That's why many of us are here. You know, we wear these labels. We create labels for ourselves. Oh, I'm Catholic, I'm Protestant, I'm Methodist, I'm Baptist, I'm Pentecostal. No, we believe you should baptize back ways. No, I'm a sideways, I believe. When you walked the earth, he was plain and straight and clear. It wasn't a matter of fact. Who did he dislike the most was the religious order of the day. Jeremiah says it in the prophecy. Don't listen to your prophets, they are telling you lies. Sometimes, not all the time, don't get me wrong, but sometimes religion can be an obstacle to connecting with God. And this is the final point I want to make. The second scripture that we read was from John 15. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Brothers and sisters, if we want to recognize and achieve the purpose in life, we heard about Lucilla's life and the impact she has made. All of us here, if it hasn't happened already, we're going to come face to face with death in our family. But guess what? We have a God who sees beyond that. And God has a purpose for us and a plan. You know, last time I was up here, I shared one of my most favorite scriptures. From time to time, I have different ones, but this one remains with me. That after a lifetime of poor decision-making and theft, at Golgotha, beside Jesus Christ, there were two men. And one just said, Father, remember me. Remember me. It's not about what he did in his life or what he didn't do. He just reached out to him and said, God, remember me. And he got an assurance that I yearn for. Today, you will be with me in paradise. Sadly enough, there was another man right beside him who died with a string of profanity, who lived a life that was purposeless. The scripture we read this morning speaks to it. It's not because God desires to take away branches, but it's a fact. Outside of him, we can do nothing. I close with this story that was shared by Joel Osteen. Now, I know some of you are not, I'm not a big fan of televangelists, but still, they have a word and a message to take. And in one of his books, Joel Osteen shared this story that today it really impacted me. He was driving with one of his congregational members, one of his congregants, around the street of Dallas in Texas, around the highway that you look in the distance and you see Dallas. And this guy that was driving him was one of the premier developers in the city of Dallas and was responsible for many of the skyscrapers. And he was traveling with Joel and said, you know, I did that building. My company did that building and that, and it was so impressive. Joel said, you know, just gazing and saying, boy, you must feel so proud. You have changed the skyline of a city. Your impact is here. And he heard silence. I wondered what happened. And he looked. Tears were rolling down the guy's face. He said, Pastor, I hate every square foot of this. You wouldn't begin to understand. It cost me my marriage. It cost me my relationship with my children. When I look on that skyline, I look back on the mistakes I've made in my life and I hate every square foot of it. Sometimes what we think is our purpose and our calling ain't our purpose and our calling. God has a plan for us. And just like Henry Ford, God wants us to walk in that plan. It's not some mystery that he says, boy, you have 17 doors and you choose door 12 in, and it's 17 I wanted you to do. Those of you I are in fifth form or third form, our educational system forces us to choose arts or sciences at an early age before we even know how to spell it. And it was such a big thing, boy, I like arts, but I don't know what to... And if you allow yourself, you can get confused as to what your purpose is. Your purpose in life is John 15. Remain in me, and I remain in you, and you will be fruitful. Not because of anything you have done, not because of any credential you can bring to the table, but the act of connection with the vine. The act of connection with the vine will allow you to be fruitful and achieve the purpose for which you were created. I don't know how many of you ever tried to. I had the task the other day. I needed a screwdriver and I couldn't find one. I started to use a scissors to unscrew something. Or you might have the same screwdriver and need a hammer and you start to use the back of the screwdriver to hammer. You realize it don't pencil out, you know. We are created for a specific purpose. Folks, God has a plan for you. I know I said it would be my last thing, but I'm going to share one more thing with you. Because it's heavy on my heart. I shared it this morning. My mother grew up in Spalding's there and Kingston. A little country girl. And she got an opportunity, her older brother. We don't begin to understand those years. Some of the older ones of you would remember wartime and how war, you think COVID is anything? World War II changed the face of the earth. And her brother went away. And anyway, long and short, called her to study. She got an opportunity to study in McGill. And she went and she did social sciences. And she left here with all kind of plans of, boy, I want to do social work and come back and change Jamaica. As part of the studies in Canada, she did French on the side. She came back to Jamaica, and for the 40-odd years of her teaching, she taught Spanish. Never even did it. Thankfully, though, I'm here because of those decisions. So I'm glad. Don't get me wrong. And it wasn't until she retired and she got an opportunity in her retirement, in the twilight of her career, to go and work at the Women's Center. And those were some of the most rewarding years of her life, where she could now use the social sciences and impact the life of young girls and make a lasting impact. That's how God works, you know. We think that God wants us, that we should do X. But when we remain in him and he in us, when we have that connection, we don't have to try. Fruit will come. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for your love for us. We thank you that you have a purpose for our life. Help us to realize, Lord, that we are not defined by our past mistakes, by the poor decisions we have made, by the sin that weighs us down. In you, in connection with you, we have the victory over all of those things. We can be fruitful. We can achieve the purpose for which you created us by the act of remaining in you. Help our walk, Lord. Be close to us. We ask in your precious name. Amen. As we close the service, we want to sing this song, Draw Me Close to You. And let us continue in an attitude of prayer. Be you here or in the internet somewhere, wherever you are, you can make a decision. You could be a Christian, you could be a Christian leader, you could be a non-Christian. Forget the labels that you have. This morning, the God that designed us and created us wants a connection with you. He wants you to remain in him. And as we sing that song, musicians, we can make that our prayer. We can cry out to him, Lord, draw me close to you.
If you are not connected, if you are disconnected from the vine, you're going to whittle away. You're going to dry up. But if you connect with the Lord, you'll find meaning and purpose for your life. You'll discover a new reason to wake up every morning. Because you will know without a doubt that your life is not aimless. That there's one who will direct your steps and guide your path and lead you into what it really means to live a fruitful life. wherever you are, whether in the sanctuary or online, I invite you to make where you are an altar. Say to the Lord, I want to be closer to you. Maybe you've already made a commitment, but that commitment is waning. It is loose. You want to tighten up the connection. Or maybe I've never yet made a commitment. The Lord is here and he's opening up himself to receive you and to reconnect with you and to connect with you in a real way that makes life worth living. Let me sing it one more time from the top. Wherever you are, just talk to the Lord.
Draw me close to you.
Just lay down everything. Lay it all down.
I lay it all down again. To hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire.
No one, absolutely no one else will do.
No one else will do. Nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring me back to you.
Choices made. Maybe they feel far away from you, distant. And you are saying, I want to be close to you. I have a plan and a purpose for your life. I want you to discover who you truly were meant to be. Lord, may they hear your word today. Deep within the recesses of their heart, Lord, may they hear that word, that invitation, that offer that says you have a plan for them. A hopeful future laid out for them. All they need to do is respond to you, to abide in you, to answer and to act, to understand that their life doesn't belong to themselves, belongs to you. So Lord, as your word has gone forth, speech and in song and in scripture, draw someone to yourself today, O God. May this mark a new beginning, may for start a whole new chapter in their life. Spirit of God, do that work of convicting and convincing and converting. Someone was heard this message. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
If you want somebody to talk to, we'd be more than happy to have conversation about how you can be drawn closer to the Lord.
Thank you, Reverend. As we prepare our hearts for a prayer of thanksgiving and intercession by Ms. Joan Page Bain, we'll continue to sing the chorus, "You're All I Want." Ms. Page Bain comes and gives the prayer of thanksgiving and intercession.
You're all I want. You're all I ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you.
My soul longeth, yes, fainted for thy courts. My soul, my heart, and my flesh crieth out for the living God, because truly in his presence there is fullness of joy, and his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. This morning, Lord God, we come thanking you for this privilege that you have given to us. Thank you, Lord God, that we have drawn close and we know that you are here. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you that you have kept us. Great is your mercy towards us. You have kept us, Lord, through another week, giving us the privilege of smelling the freshly mown grass, the cleanliness of the air after it rains. We thank you, Lord, for the beauty of the flowers. We thank you, Lord God, as we look and we see the birds and the bees going from flower to flower. What a good God that you are. We thank you, Lord, that you have provided food for us. You have provided clothing, a shelter. We give you thanks. Lord, as we thank you for your provisions, we think of the many of our brothers and sisters here in Jamaica and other countries who are not as privileged as we are. Lord God, we ask you once again to make provisions for our brothers and sisters who have been washed out, Lord, after these flood rains. They have been marooned, Lord. They still cannot get to the market to sell their provisions. God in heaven, we ask you, please, to make provisions for them. And help us too to realize that we are our brother's keepers. Help us to do what we can, because Lord, we are your hands extended. For our children, many are not yet in school because they have no tablet, they have no laptop, they have no smartphone. Help us, Lord God, to reach out to them. And if it even means us joining with somebody else to provide that which is needed for this child, I pray, God, that you'll help us so to do. Father, in this pandemic, you are still here. Please, Lord God, touch the many who are affected. And in fact, Lord God, I can say that we are all affected. But Lord, I especially want to bring to you, Lord, those who are infected. Visit them, Lord, and their families. Some have lost loved ones to this pandemic. Please be close to them. And for the rest of us, Lord God, who might not be infected, but of course affected, socially, emotionally, financially, and spiritually. Please, Lord God, have mercy. We think once again, Lord, of our home, this Jamaica, a country of splendor and beauty, yet it is daily becoming ugly by our garbage in the streets, by our plastic in the sea, and by the blood and the tears of our brothers and sisters and children crying out, how long, how long? Lord, hear our prayers. Hear our prayers, Lord. We think of our mountains and our rivers. Lord, we think of the way we have been affecting and destroying, Lord God, our mountainside. As we abuse, Lord, this beautiful country, I pray that you will have mercy upon us. Speak to those who are in charge. Our brothers and sisters are killed. Lord, we wonder because of greed. Lord, we continue to destroy them. We think of that family. We think of Marcia, who this week in this part of the country have been killed. And Lord God, we already know that even though those who have been given the opportunity or the privilege of serving us, Lord, they're on top of the situation. Lord, we thank you for our policing. We ask you, Lord God, that even as these persons are brought to justice, that you'll cause that others will understand that you're a God who is in charge. And as been pointing out this morning, you are in control. You are in control. And even though you have asked us, you have given us the privilege of settling, help us to realize that we cannot and ought not to settle alone, but we should think of others. At this time too, Lord God, I want to think of those who are sick and shut in. You know those among us. Lord, again, we think of the family of Lucilda. We ask you, Lord God, to be with them. And the strength that she brought to them in her lifetime, I pray that they'll draw it from you. Others, Lord God, who are mourning, please be with them. Bless our pastor and his wife. We commit the board of elders and deacons to you. We ask you, Lord, to bless them and their families. Help us today to rise up and live up to the mandate that you have given to us. As we think of this Sunday or Evangelism Sunday, I pray, Lord God, you'll help us truly to go out and to make disciples, whether here in Jerusalem or to the utmost parts of the earth. As you have reminded them, you are same to us. Lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. Hear our prayers, Lord, and let our cries come unto you as we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we draw our service to a close, I'm not sure if someone is assigned for no memory. The sending. Go ahead. Okay, could we stand for the sending, please? God invites us into a future where he will make all things new.
Together in mourning, crying, pain, and even death will be no more.
Remember God's future, for this is our story.
Our Lord says, see, I'm coming soon. And we respond, come Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Even so, come Lord Jesus. I want to thank you all for joining us in worship today and invite you to join us again next Sunday, God willing, when we will gather for worship.
Just before we go, I have just two legal notices I need to make, so bear with me. Notice has been this day received by me of a marriage as intended between to be solemnized between the following persons: Peter Anthony Sawyers, bachelor landscaper of Knockpatrick, Manchester, and Lemaine De Niro Gale, divorced customer service representative of Knockpatrick, Manchester. All objections to a certificate of due publication of banns granted authorizing the celebration of this marriage must be lodged with me in writing within 7 clear days from this date by the objector, who must appear personally to declare to the truth thereof. Notice has also been received of a marriage intended to be solemnized between the following persons: Kenil Orlando White, bachelor farmer of Devon, Manchester, and Cherian Nicalia Brown Spencer, college student of Newcomb Valley, St. Elizabeth. All objections to a certificate of due publication of banns granted authorizing the celebration of this marriage must be lodged with me in writing within 7 clear days from this date by the objector, who must appear personally to declare to the truth thereof. And it's signed by Anthony Chum, marriage officer. All right, so these will be posted. Friends, have a blessed week. And as you leave from this place, carry the praise with you, carry the hope of the Lord with you. And may grace, mercy, and peace from God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and with your loved ones near and far, this and every day. Amen. Got my mind made up, and I won't turn back.
I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, 'cause I want to see my Jesus someday. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, 'cause I want to see my Jesus someday. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, 'cause I want to see my Jesus someday. I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, 'cause I want to see my Jesus someday. Goodbye world, I'll say no longer with you. Goodbye pleasures of sin, I'll stay no longer with you. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life. I made up my mind to go God's way the rest of my life. Born, born, born again. Thank God I'm born again. Born, born, born again. Thank God I'm born again. Born of the water, the Spirit, and the blood.
Got my
mind made up, and I